morning and Merry Christmas. It is great to be with you all this morning. Just a few announcements as we get started and get going. First of all, welcome to those of you joining us on Facebook Live. Merry Christmas to you as well. And it is a joy. We have Sunday school that meets in the back corner classroom at 9:45. I want to invite you to join us for that. We are currently doing a study on the Ten Commandments. So join us for that. There will not be a prayer meeting in my office this Wednesday. And so, again, I want to encourage you and invite you to pray. But this Wednesday, if you come, you will be by yourself. But you can't pray by yourself. men, we do have our men's group meeting this Friday, December 30th, at Joe De Leon's house from 8 to 9. And we will be reading and discussing Matthew chapter 26 this week, at least the first part of it, because it's a long chapter. So we'll at least be discussing the first half. And also, again, just a heads up, mark your calendars. It's in the bulletin, but on Sunday, January 8th, which is actually just 2 weeks away, we will have our 2023 planning meeting right after church in the fellowship hall, and pizza lunch will be provided by the church. And again, if you're looking for the offering, it is in the back normally when you go out the door, but now it's under the big bulletin board if you're looking for the offering. And again, it is a joy to be with you all. Thank you for our worship team leading us this morning, Christmas morning. And I hope you all have already had just a wonderful morning celebration of Christ's birth, and I want that to continue today. And so if you would please stand, we will join together in worship singing.
Good morning. We're going to begin with Joy to the World, which was originally written based off of Psalms 98, which is, sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel, and all the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for the Lord, before the Lord, the King. So we're going to begin with Joy to the World. And we have no harps, but we brought our trumpets for you. So we have a little intro, and then jump in with us.
Thank you.
we come this morning, just that our hearts would unfold, and then we would just begin to think about that precious story that is truth and life-changing as we come into just thinking about what Jesus did for us on that day.
Oh, come. Lord, let me get that for you. I got it. You know, so. Good morning. I'm so happy to be with all of you. And your guys' offering this morning, to take a detour off the children's sermon. And Psalm 150 says, praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with sounding of the trumpet. Woohoo! We got to do that today. That is not every Sunday we get to do that. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. So next time. And praise him with the timbrel and the dancing. So you guys, we have more songs to sing. Praise him with the strings and the pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. So thank you guys this morning that we got to like praise the Lord with song, but also like with a trumpet. That was pretty fantastic. Okay, so back to our regularly scheduled program of the children's sermon. Our scripture this morning is found in Matthew 11, and it says, when John, who was in prison, heard about the deeds of the Messiah, he sent his disciples to ask him, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? And Jesus replied, go back and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, and those who have leprosy are cleansed. The deaf hear, the dead are raised, and the good news is proclaimed to the poor. So, this is a star. Sorry, a little repeat of last night. This is a star, right? And when I was a little girl, I would often wait in the evening sky for the first star to appear so I could say this little poem, starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight. I wish I may, I wish I might have this wish I wish tonight. And then I would hope that those wishes would come true, right? And they probably, some of them did, but not because I wished on a star or said the right poem, right? And so at the time of Jesus, people would often watch the sky at night to see if something was going to happen. It was a saying sometimes that a special person was going to be born, then there would be a sign in the heavens that they were born. And so we know that Jesus was born under the sign of the star when the Magi found him, but also people were still quite a bit confused about who Jesus was and what he was going to do. Even his own cousin, you would think John the Baptist, out of all the people, would be like, I got your number, we've known each other since we were small fry, we know each other, you're it. But even he, when he was in jail, is like, are you going to be it? And so he says, are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? And Jesus' answer was beautiful, and it was displayed in your song this morning, right? You guys sang, Mary, did you know? And then it gave all these reasons in the song about how all the things that Jesus did. And that is our sign of wonder, is the way that Jesus touches all of our lives, right? He makes things new. He heals us in amazing ways. And we get to celebrate his birthday today. So it's time to light the candles. I keep making you do this, but you don't have to. Do you want to light candles with me? Okay, you can. Do you want to back there? No? Okay. They never know, and I just put them on the spot. So we have our Advent candles here. And while LJ lights them, look, you get to light them all by yourself today. That's pretty thrilling. So the first candle is the candle of hope, the hope we have in Jesus. This second candle is the hope that we have, not the hope, but the joy that can be found in him. We have peace, the peace that we have internally and externally in our lives, like the mental peace that can come from him and also in the world. And then the last candle of our Advent is the love candle, that we know that God loves us so much that he sent his son. And lastly, the Christ candle for his birthday, because we celebrate Jesus today and his coming. That's pretty exciting, huh? Thanks, LJ. She got to light them all. That's pretty fun. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for the signs of your coming and that you're here and alive and active in our lives. We ask you to help us to pay attention, to be thoughtful and mindful of and curious about the work that you're doing, about people around us, about how you still are giving us signs about your work and your workmanship. And we just ask you to give us the eyes to see that, and that we would treasure those things in our hearts and remember them. In your name we pray, amen.
Thank you. At this point in our service, we have the opportunity to go before God in prayer as a whole congregation. And during this time, I want to invite you, if you feel comfortable, to go ahead and pray a prayer out loud during this time. And if you're not comfortable doing that, no problem. I want to invite you to just pray silently with us. And if you're here this morning or joining us on Facebook Live and you just feel like you're not sure how to pray or even what to pray, again, no problem, because Scripture tells us that the Spirit will pray on our behalf. So let's go before God in prayer. Oh, Lord, we do praise you and thank you for this morning, for the day that we celebrate your birth. And Lord, for that greatest gift of all. And Lord, it's such an amazing gift. You loved us so much. And it's made even more amazing because we have hindsight of knowing what would happen at the end of your life. And so, Lord, we do acknowledge that gift of the gift of your Son. But the greatness of that gift was because he was willing to go to the cross for the forgiveness of our sins so that we might be children of God. Not because of anything that we have done and not because of who we are, but because of who Jesus Christ is and because of what he has done. And as a result, believing in him, we are adopted as your children, and you invite us. You encourage us to come directly to you in prayer. And so, Lord, we are blessed to have that opportunity. And so we come before you now as a congregation and pray. So hear us, Lord, as we pray together. Lord, we do pray for those many who are traveling today. Just pray for their protection, their safety. Lord, we pray for the many hundreds of thousands that have been impacted by just horrible cold and storms from the Midwest and East. Lord, just pray for their protection as well. Lord, we pray for those who are not feeling well, who are ill or not feeling well. We pray for healing for them. Lord, for your hand of comfort during this time of illness. And Lord, again, we just praise you and thank you for the chance, the opportunity to gather together, to worship you, to lift up your name, to be able to proudly, publicly proclaim you to the world. And so, Lord, may we continue to do that just like the angels did, of proudly proclaiming your Son and all that he did. And Lord, we praise you and thank you for this. We pray, Lord, this morning that you'd open our hearts and our ears and our minds to hear from you what you want to teach us this morning. And Lord, in all that we are, in all that we do, individually as well as a congregation, may you, Lord, be glorified. It's in your mighty name that we pray. Amen. We will have our scripture reading. Let me get the overhead down. I know you're not using that, but for our prayer.
Scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 77, 11 through 14. I will remember the deeds of the Lord. Yes, I will remember your miracles of long ago. I will meditate on all your works and consider your mighty deeds. Your ways, O God, are holy. What God is so great as our God? You are the God who performs miracles. You display your power among the peoples. Please join me in prayer. Sing this together. You can stand and sing.
Sure.
I think I beat you to it. Sorry.
Okay.
Gosh, what a wonderful story, but it's more than a story of a cute little baby in a manger. And I don't know about you, but I don't think a baby in a manger sounds real cute. But of a life-giving gift that ends on the cross to rescue us because we need him so much. We need Jesus. And so let's join together.
Yes, I'm
So this morning, I would like to invite you to open your Bibles to our scripture this morning, which is Luke chapter 2, verses 10 through 12. And I want to start by saying one thing I love about scripture and studying scripture is not only is it the living word, but how God will just, the Spirit will reveal new things and new things and new things, even with scripture that's been read over and over and over again. I preached on a little part of this passage last Sunday. I preached on a little part of this passage last night. And I'm preaching on a part of it this morning. All three different things that God has taught me through it and that I want to share with you. And so the sermon title for this morning is Great Joy. So read along with me the passage for this morning, Luke chapter 2, verses 10 through 12. It says, "But the angel said to the shepherds, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.'" Of all of the wonderful promises contained in the Christmas story, the one that seems, at least to me, to be missing the most today is great joy. I'd even ask, and I'll ask it rhetorically, not asking for an answer, but how many people do you know that would describe their life as being full of great joy? And yet, that is the proclamation by the angel to the shepherds. The Savior of the world would bring good news of great joy for all people. The angel declared joy. Mary and Joseph were amazed with joy. The wise men were filled with joy. The shepherds returned with rejoicing in their hearts. And even John the Baptist leaped for joy in Elizabeth's womb. Now, I'm sure that we all could sit down and make a long list of reasons for the lack of joy in our lives. And the list would most certainly include, for many if not all of us, sickness, stress, setbacks, suffering, struggles in life, sin in our own lives and in the world around us. And the biggest mistake that we often make is to think that happiness and joy are one and the same. If you've been with us here before, you've heard me preach on that. Because we see in Scripture that's not the case. And I've mentioned this before, but happiness depends on the circumstances of one's life. If my life happens the way I want it to happen, then I'm happy. The word for joy, on the other hand, is a relationship word. Being part of a family, for instance, does not change if you become sick or poor or lose your job or are homeless. The Bible tells us that the shepherds returned with joy in their hearts, but the circumstances of their lives did not suddenly change because of this Christmas announcement. When they returned after seeing the baby Jesus, they were still financially poor. They were still considered the lowest class of the social order, with the only people being seen as lower than being the lepers. Their sheep still smelled bad and still required constant care. They returned to the same wife and kids they had before Jesus was born, but they were full of joy. Their response illustrates a secret to joy that many miss. So how
can we be unhappy about our circumstances in our lives, but still have joy? Well, our text gives us some hints as to how this happens. And I want to just quickly go over the four hints that our text gives us. The first key to understanding this Christmas joy is to understand our personal significance. The first key is to understand our personal significance. It's to ask, how important are we to God? And it is true that Scripture warns us against thinking too highly of ourselves, but you must also understand who God created you to be. You are not an accident. God created you on purpose. Notice in the Christmas message what the angel said to the shepherds, "For unto you." Imagine what this truth meant to those shepherds. God's amazing love was for them. They may not make the front page of the Jerusalem Times, but they made it into the pages of Scripture. They were special because God loved them. God cared for them, and He cares for you and for me. I have a friend from Colorado who told me about a time when his son was in first grade. His son's teacher gave a star sticker to students who did their work, listened to their teacher, or demonstrated kindness to other students. While his son went on a star crusade. At the dinner table each night, the family would receive the star report, and this boy would tell the whole family how many stars he received and which boys didn't get stars and the reason they didn't. Now, these little paper stickers have a monetary value of less than a penny, but they were invaluable treasures to this boy. And why? Because the star meant that somebody noticed him. Someone thinks he is special. Well, guess what? God thinks that each one of you is special. And while he does not give stickers to prove his love, he did send his only begotten son. Well, the second key to experience great joy is to move, trusting the promises of God. It's to move, trusting the promises of God. The instructions to the shepherds were to go to the city of David, the town of Bethlehem. They did not just receive that good news and go back to tending their sheep. No, they got up and they went to Bethlehem. The birth of Christ in Bethlehem was a fulfillment of numerous prophecies about the Messiah. Jesus Christ is not only the fulfillment of Scripture, He is the Word of God. Mm-hmm. And we encounter His guidance, His peace, and His joy throughout the precious promises of His Word. But those promises are made for us to act upon them. We can trust the promises of God when it says, "You are loved. God will never leave you. He has a plan for your life. Though you go through the valley of the shadow of death, His goodness and mercy will follow you all the days of your life." You can rejoice because this is the day that the Lord has made. C.S. Lewis said that God must find our prayers very weak indeed when compared to all the promises offered to believers. And so move, trusting the promises of God. Number three, the third key to experiencing great joy is knowing that your sins are forgiven. Knowing that your sins are forgiven. The angels declared that a Savior is born. The saving work of Christ is not a political revolt or an economic revolution. It is the forgiveness of sin. King David said in Psalm 32:1, "Happy is the man whose transgression is forgiven and whose sin is covered. Sin consists of the unrighteous deeds that we commit and those things that we omit to include in our lives. Sin separates us from a holy God. Sin causes pain and suffering. And the pain can be physical consequences or emotional trauma created by living a life in disobedience to God's will and plan for our lives. For people who have not trusted Christ as their Savior, the words of the great hymn, "Joy to the World," summarize what needs to be done. Let every heart prepare him room. And for those of us who know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, Peter says that we need to develop a far-sighted faith, never forgetting the cleansing of past sins. Another worship psalm states, "Restore to me the joy of my salvation." And when we continually remember that glorious day when our sins were forgiven, it keeps joy in our heart. Jesus is the Savior of the world, and his salvation produces great joy. Well, fourth and finally, a fourth key to this Christmas joy is to know that we never stand alone in our Christian journey. We never stand alone in our Christian journey. God has placed us in a family of believers who support us, encourage us, and pray for us. While Mary received the angel's message by herself, it did not take Joseph long after his angel visit to take her as his wife, to support her, and to stand by her. And while we do not know what the rest of her family, how they reacted to the news of her pregnancy, we do know that Elizabeth was there for her. Even after the birth of the baby, Mary and Joseph were not alone, because angels told shepherds about what had happened. The Christmas shepherds are described as rejoicing together over what they had experienced. A wise man once said that friends double our joys and divide our sorrows. And developing these positive and supportive relationships are critical to us following Christ and experiencing joy. Believers in Christ are described in Scripture as members of the same family, as parts of the same body, and as stones of the same building. Without significant relationships, people cannot possess the promise of great joy. We can't go it alone. We need one another. That's how God created us and designed us. Another friend of mine, Jeff, shared with me an experience he had with his granddaughter, Brianna. Brianna asked Jeff to do some puzzles with her. And so they poured out the pieces, and Jeff set the box up so that they could see the picture. Well, Jeff noticed that Brianna never once looked at the box. She just started putting the pieces together, not even doing the edge pieces first. Occasionally, she would look at her grandfather and smile. And this process repeated itself with several puzzles, and Jeff realized a major difference between he and his granddaughter. Jeff was setting the box up with the picture showing and starting with the edge pieces because his goal was to complete the task by putting the puzzle together in the most effective manner. Brianna's goal, however, was simply to enjoy spending time with her grandpa. Well, Zig Ziglar, management guru and author, reported in his book, Over the Top, that preschoolers will laugh, giggle, or smile over 400 times a day. Maybe that's why Jesus said to experience the kingdom of heaven, we must become as a little child. And with that, great joy is God's Christmas gift to you and to me. And so my encouragement to you this morning is, please don't wait to open it. Amen. If you will stand, we will have our closing worship song and then our benediction for this morning. Now, receive today's benediction, which comes from Luke chapter 2, verses 10 and 11 and 13 and 14. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." Amen. Amen. Have a very merry Christmas. Amen.